quite a number of you may actually have been part way through, already a long way, I guess, on in the prostate cancer journey. So you're a bit beyond the diagnostic side, or perhaps the treatment of very early stage prostate cancer. So I thought that a good topic would be to talk about this very new scan called a gallium-68 PSMA PET scan. I'm not sure how many have actually heard of this type of scan. Have any of you actually had this scan performed? Not as yet. Oh, well, at least one person has. And I can guarantee you that if I were asked the same question in about a year or two from now, there'll be a much greater number of people who would have had this type of scan, irrespective of what stage of the journey you are through with regard to prostate cancer. All right, at this point in time, you're probably thinking, what on earth is this gallium-68 PSMA PET scan? Never heard of it, and we've heard vague rumblings of it, but you have no real, idea as to what it's about. Well, this diagram really makes it easy, doesn't it? Well, it's a picture, a very complicated picture of a cell wall. But the key point I'm trying to make is that the PSMA is actually an enzymatic protein that actually lies literally within the cell wall. And because it is a protein that's very particular to prostate cancer cells, then it acts as a potential target by which we could perform diagnostics or even go as far as offering targeted drug treatments. Well, PSMA stands for prostate surface membrane antigen. So when you think about it, it's on the surface of the cell, and it's actually quite relatively specific for the prostate itself, although the name term specific is not in there, like PSA. It's seen in normal prostate cells, but to a much lesser extent than we see in prostate cancer cells. Now, when you have got prostate cancer cells, it's especially expressed, or in other words, it's quite abundant in so-called poorly differentiated prostate cancers. They tend to be the really aggressive cancers. Cancers that have already spread, but that sort of goes hand in hand. If you've got an aggressive cancer, then it's got a high propensity to spread. And it's also especially expressed in those men who've got what we call castration-resistant prostate cancer. Now, castration-resistant prostate cancer, just to step back a little, is the cancer that has started to fail to respond to what we call androgen deprivation therapy or hormone treatment. So it's in the more advanced stages of the disease when things are starting to march onwards. Okay, that's a little bit about the PSMA. What about PET scans? Well, a PET scan stands for positron emission tomography. And it works on the basis that, positrons aren't in themselves detected, but that's the manner by which we can acquire images. These tests are almost always performed in conjunction with a low-dose CT scan. And we are starting to see some centres where they're actually combining the PET scan with an MRI scan. But at the moment, the idea of doing that combination is prohibitively expensive. All right, now, there is a little bit of detail here, but for those of you who aren't particularly scientifically inclined, you're very welcome to tune out for a few moments. But I'll do my best to try to give you some sort of idea as to how this scan works, as opposed to other types of scans. So you all know what a radioisotope is where we get a radioactive molecule and you attach it to another compound, usually another protein or some sort of chemical. So it's attached to a carrier compound which has the ability to be taken up by the target cells. So therefore, if you use a PSMA-like substance that gets taken up by the prostate cancer cell membrane or the cell wall, so that provides a nice opportunity to get this radioactive material to the prostate cancer cells. Now, as you know, radiation, when you've got a radioactive material, it undergoes decay. And this is where it gets a bit tricky with the physics, so again, feel free to tune out if this is too complicated. When radioactive material decays, it releases these particles called positrons. And these positrons will collide with what we call electrons. And when they collide, you get this process called annihilation. In other words, the two are simply destroyed. And what happens is that they're converted into what we call gamma rays. And these gamma rays actually go off at, here we go, positrons hitting an electron there, the red hitting the yellow. And what ends up happening is that you end up with these so-called gamma rays. These disappear and become these gamma rays, which is basically radiation. And the gamma rays go off at in opposite directions. So therefore, if you have a donut-like camera structure, it can actually work out by calculating, it can make calculations on how it's detected it. And as it's working its way around in a circular manner, you can actually work out where the area is that the isotope has landed. Okay, that's going to be about all there should be with the more complicated stuff. Now, this is a picture of what a PET scanner looks like. And this is a PET scanner that's combined with a CT scan. Now, this is David McHarg here, who's one of the nuclear physicians at this hospital. And I really must give David a lot of credit for going to the enormous trouble of setting up this PET PSMA service, which we now have available at the SAN. And I'll explain to you a little bit later on why it is such a challenge to set up this type of service. There are many different types of PET scans, and you can end up with all sorts of fancy images like this. Now, this is not from a PET PSMA. This is actually one which was done looking for lymphoma. It's called FDG PET. But anyway, you get the idea. You can get these amazing images from this type of scanning. It's very sophisticated technology. Now, there are a whole different range of sort of PET scans. Yes, PET scans have been around for quite a number of years. In fact, the very earliest ones have been around for at least a couple of decades. So often when you say, oh, there's a new PET scan for prostate cancer, people say, well, PET scan, there's nothing new. They've been around for ages, you know. But the thing is that the one which is very specific for prostate, which is the PET PSMA scan, has only been available in Australia since last year. So it's very, very new. I think it was up at the Wesley Hospital in Brisbane where the first place in Australia to acquire this technology, and may have been about early or middle of last year. And subsequent to that, we've seen a number of institutions gradually acquiring the technology. In Sydney, it's only been available since November, but in terms of being available to the general public, really not until perhaps January or February this year. Now, to explain why it's not that easy to set up a PET scan, PET PSMA service. Now, the thing is that just because you've got the hardware, like that big contraption that Dave McHarg was standing next to, doesn't mean that you can automatically start doing PET PSMA scans. You need to have what's called a gallium 68 generator. What's that? Well, what is, you need to be able to make your own tracer on site. That is the radioisotope. And the reason why you've got to make it on site is that the half-life of this isotope is only 68 minutes. In other words, after 68 minutes, it's already lost half its radiation. So therefore, after 2 hours, it's lost 75% of all its radiation. So that's so therefore, it decays very quickly. So just imagine if you order the stuff from Lucas Heights, for example, and you want them to ship it up to the SAN, the stuff's going to be dead by the time you get round to using it. So you can see that instead of ordering your radioisotopes, which has been the more traditional type of approach, the very short half-life makes this a really difficult service to commence. So that means you've got to make your own stuff. So you've got to buy these generators, and these generators are very expensive in themselves. Just that box, which is only about so big, which generates this isotope, they're around about $40,000 to $50,000 just for that. And then you've got to get it attached to the PSMA molecule. And so there's a bit of lab work that's involved, and that actually takes time. It can take a good couple of hours for lab technicians just to get it all set up. So therefore, when a patient comes in for a PET PSMA scan, there's a lot going on in the background, a lot of preparation, and the preparation is done especially for that patient or for that group of patients. Because so if you have a situation where you made this isotope and then the machine breaks down, this very expensive isotope all goes to waste. So you only make it on the day in which you're going to do the scan. So that is the reason why I take my hat off to Dr. David McHugh for taking a big risk in a big financial outlay to get the service started, and also a lot of effort in getting his personnel around into helping to run the service. I think it's an essential service, and I'll explain to you why shortly. All right, when should we do these PSMA scans? Well, at the moment, much of the evidence behind doing these PSMA scans is based on circumstantial rather than high-quality clinical trials. There's a lot of early trials that have demonstrated that this seems to be so dramatically more effective than other forms of imaging. And also when you think about the theory by which it works, it's one of those things with times when you think that this is, I don't need a parachute to convince me that it's a good idea to put a parachute, sorry, I don't need a clinical trial to prove to me that I need to wear a parachute if I jump out of a plane. And that's one of the reasons why we're seeing a very rapid uptake of this technology in the absence of very robust clinical trials. It is changing as we acquire the technology. We've got a duty to actually report back our experience to demonstrate that what we're doing actually is a good thing to do. There still is an issue with false positives where you'll see some areas will light up on the scan, but it's not due to prostate cancer. So we're still in that learning period. I'll give you an example. We had one patient where a lesion in the lung lit up. And it did not add up clinically. It did not seem like this was prostate cancer, because it's an atypical place for prostate cancer to go. The shape of the lesion, the size of the lesion on the scan didn't add up. And what it turned out to be was an unusual tumor called a fibrous tumor. It's a very rare type of lung tumor. And this lit up. So we're actually learning that there are certain types of tumors which will, which will appear to be PSMA avid, or will seem to give the impression there's prostate cancer going on, but there in fact is not. We still have the issue with false negatives, and that's always a function of the scan resolution. So you remember, if you've got a spot of prostate cancer, let's say it's a 1 millimeter focus, there's no scan, no matter how sophisticated, is ever going to be able to pick that up, something as small as 1 millimeter. But then again, I've got to be careful with saying that, because once upon a time we said that anything less than 5 millimeters, there's no way any scan will pick that up. And here we go, we've got a scan before us that is now capable of doing that. All right, so what are the indications for PET PSMA scans? We're currently using it to perform staging after diagnosis, or in other words, an extent of disease assessment after making a diagnosis of prostate cancer. We're also using it to help identify recurrent disease. So say if somebody has already undergone treatment with radiation treatment or with surgery, then and the PSA is starting to go up, then this is a very useful scan to help identify where that disease is located. The other thing is that it is also, there's a lot less work done in this area, but it's also thought that this scan will have some use even in men with castration-resistant prostate cancer. So one way we think that it might help is that if somebody's got a high, if they've got localized disease or spots of disease, even though the hormone treatment's not working, they just might benefit from having radiation to those areas to help slow down the progression of the disease. And the other way in which we think it might be helpful is as we're evaluating new treatments for castration-resistant prostate cancer, it's sometimes hard to know whether we're actually making a difference or not. And a PET PSMA scan might be a good way of measuring the amount of disease there is after you try a new type of treatment. We've already learnt with abiraterone and with enzalutamide, those two new wonder drugs, you could say, that sometimes the PSA blood test level is not always an ideal indicator as to whether you're making a difference or not. So that's why we rely very heavily upon scans to tell us if those drugs are working or not. I'm not saying that PSA is not useful, but in a lot of instances, it's not always giving the true picture. All right, let's go talk a bit about staging, how we use it in staging. We're fairly satisfied that a PET PSMA scan is clearly superior to the conventional CT scan of the abdomen and pelvis, and to the nuclear medicine bone scan. And I'm sure that most of you in this room have undergone either one or both of these scans in the context of prostate cancer at some stage. And it's probably better than a total body MRI scan as well, although there's limited data on direct head-to-head comparisons. Again, I emphasize that when it comes to staging, this scan is still limited by the ability to detect the very small lesions that are beyond the resolution of this scan. So what types of patients would I use it when we're staging? Well, increasingly, most urologists are starting to use this scan for staging men who have been diagnosed with what we call high-risk prostate cancer. And just to give you an example, a patient with high-risk prostate cancer would be somebody who's got, a Gleason score of at least 4+4, and they may have disease that has clinically extended well beyond the prostate capsule. But the other group I also have added to the mix are those with the so-called high-tier intermediate-risk prostate cancer. You might know, as you know, those patients who have got, say, a Gleason score 7, it's a bit of a heterogeneous group where you've got good 7s and you've got bad 7s. And for those who've got, say, the Gleason score 4+3s, they're the ones I tend to add to my mix of patients who would get that for staging. So when you do the scan, what you're looking out for is to see, are there any lymph nodes that are lighting up? Are there any bone lesions that light up? Well, hang on a sec, I've said bone lesions and lymph nodes. Can this replace a bone scan and CT scan? Well, the evidence is pointing very much towards the fact that this is actually one scan that does what both the CT scan and the bone scan do. So I guess that's one advantage of a scan, is it's one scan instead of two. So you might also argue, okay, you start picking up this disease that you never used to pick up. What are you going to do about it? How's it going to change our management? Well, let's start off with a lymph node disease. Let's say if it does pick up a number of lymph nodes, they're usually going to be in the pelvis, in the region where, not too far away from the prostate. Now, under normal circumstances, when we do what we call a lymph node dissection at the time of surgery, it's really, to some extent, a random event, because the prostate cancer can't be relied upon in terms of which lymph nodes it's going to spread to if it's going to do that. And because of that lack of reliability, we end up taking this blunderbuss approach where we remove large numbers of lymph nodes. And the problem we've got is that sometimes the prostate cancer will actually preferentially spread to a lymph node that's not in the standard zone of removal. So if we actually have some idea as to where it's likely that lymph nodes are positive, then we've got an opportunity to go and fetch those specifically. And one of the ways in which PET PSMA appears to be modifying our approach to surgery is that if you have got a positive lymph node and we know where it is, we'll focus our attention on getting the lymph nodes around that region out rather than trying to wipe out all the lymph nodes in your pelvis. The other thing is that if you're having radiation treatment, then the radiation oncologist will make a point of targeting those lymph nodes at the same time as targeting the prostate. Now, what about if there is the PET PSMA scan is positive in the bone? Now, under normal circumstances, the tradition was that if we found it in the bones on the conventional bone scan, we would say to the patient that, well, it's already spread, it's a bit too late, there's not a much we can do other than give you hormone treatment. But there's growing evidence that if it's only a limited amount of bone disease, if we actually remove the primary cancer and we treat the isolated spots, metastatic spots, that there's a significant survival advantage. And so there's been a huge shift in the way we manage men like this. Once upon a time, there was no way we would consider treating these men. But in the space of the last 1 or 2 years, our approach has changed quite drastically. All right, in the setting of a recurrent disease, well, this is when the PSA increases following definitive treatment, either with radiation or surgery. And we call that PSA biochemical failure. Now, if it's after surgery, we define PSA biochemical failure as being a PSA that reaches at least 0.2 nanograms per mil. So remember, it's a 0.2. I sometimes get men who are extremely worried when the PSA is 0.02, so it's very easy to get the decimal point mixed up there. Following radiation, we define it as the PSA nadir plus 2 nanograms per mil. What we mean by the PSA nadir is the very lowermost point that the PSA reaches after radiation. So let's say if the lowest the PSA ever reaches after somebody's had radiation is, say, 0.4 nanograms per mil, which is fine, then what we define as a failure is if it ever reaches 2.4 nanograms per mil or more. Now, this shows you some examples of a PET PSMA scan, what it looks like. And you can see it's got those pretty colours there. In fact, you could probably make it any colour you wanted by manipulating the software. But anyway, Louise Emmett from St. Vincent seems to like the blue in the background. And you can see how this is a patient who's previously undergone surgery and is found to have an isolated lymph node in a spot as marked by the arrow. And when you see that, you've got an option as to whether you could go in surgically and remove the node, or you could actually use what we call stereotactic or targeted radiation treatment. So it's like a narrow beam just attacking that node. Here's some examples of some other pretty scans. And you can see that in the urinary tract, you'll see it lights up a little bit, but the real areas which are lit up, but see where the arrow is there in the view over here? And that's that, and that's probably it as well. And it can help you identify isolated lymph nodes which are worth considering removal or eradicating in some way. Another scan, you can just make out here. And here they've drawn a circle using software. They've drawn a circle on the conventional CT scan. So you can see that when you're using the PET scan technology, which is overlaid on top of the CT scan, it gives you an idea. You actually, the combination of the PET scan and the CT, which is how it's done, gives you this, enables you to get a clear idea as to where the actual positive area is located. All right, there's been a nice little study done by Louise Emmett at St. Vincent's where they've tried to look at how has the PET CT changed the management of men who have been referred to have the study done? And what they found is that there were men who had undergone surgery in the past, and they were gazetted for surveillance. They were just going to be monitored because the CT scan, the MRI scan was clear. And what happened was they had the PET scan done, and it actually demonstrated there was a bit of lighting up in the area where the prostate used to be. So in 21% of those men, the scan actually changed the original planned management. Now, when you look at men where there was a plan to have radiation treatment, even this is again after surgery, where they're planning to give radiation to the prostate bed, and that was the plan. And what they discovered was that they found oligometastatic disease or single spots in the bone, again, for those men, the management has changed by 50%. So these patients were originally going to have pretty much just very targeted radiation, either to just the prostate bed or to maybe one spot that had been picked up on a conventional scan. And when they did the PET PSMA scan, it showed there were some additional spots, so therefore it changed the management in half of those men. So that's quite dramatic. Now, with the others, these are men who were planned, where it was planned just to give targeted treatment. And what actually ended up happening was that the PET PSMA scan ended up demonstrating that there was quite extensive disease, so it was beyond having radiation. So in other words, 29% of these men were spared from having unnecessary radiation, which would make very little to their little difference to their prognosis. So in a relatively small study here, Professor Emma has already demonstrated how this scan is having a huge impact. So when we summarise the St. Vincent's experience, they found that the PSMA detected, they also compared it to a previous scan called the choline scan, the choline PET scan, which only had a very short life in Australia. It was around for about 6 months, and before, no sooner had we started doing choline PET scans, it was superseded by the PSMA scan. And the PSMA scan was, frankly, just a lot better than the choline. The key thing is the PSMA change overall, the PSMA scan changed management, or the way in which these men were originally going to be treated, in 65% of cases. There were a small number of men, about 10 of the men actually underwent a biopsy of the positive area in the PET scan, because don't forget, at this time when they were doing the study, it was still, it's new now, but it was ultra new at that time. So a number of biopsies were taken, and in the 10 cases where the PSMA lesion was biopsied, it actually came back as positive. So the scan was actually spot on in all 10 cases. All right, when is the right time to do a PET PSMA scan if you've, say, had surgery and the PSA is rising? The thing is that you want to get the scan done early enough so you can make a difference, but at the same time, you may want to keep your powder dry. For example, if your PSA is less than 0.2, it's only maybe 29% of cases are going to have a positive scan. And if you're, in fact, that's not actually correct. It actually should be these figures here. I actually copied this directly from Louise's slide. I think she meant to say that if your PSA is less than 0.2, I think it's going to be a lower figure than that. I think she's referring to greater than 0.2 to 0.4. Because really, the vast majority of the scans done when it's less than 0.2. Well, I don't even bother recommending the scan when it's less than 0.2, so I apologise, but that's obviously an error there. So if it's at least 0.2, then it's a 29% chance of being positive. And you can see that as the PSA level goes up, the chances of the scan demonstrating where cancer is located gets better. It's still not perfect for the really small lesions when we're getting below 4 millimetres. It's possible that will change as the technology improves. As you're already aware, things are moving along very rapidly with prostate cancer. Something new happening all the time. And don't be hugely surprised if you see the PET technology continue to improve. High specificity means that if the scan says there's something there, then it's got a very high chance the scan is correct. All right, PET PSMA scan preparation. What do you have to do as a patient if you're referred to one? Well, obviously you've got to make a booking for it. And One of the problems we've got with PET PSMA scans just at this moment in a number of institutions, there is a fairly long waiting time. In some institutions, people are waiting as long as 3 or 4 months. The SAN is probably the least known, is probably the place where people least know about actually having a PET PSMA service. So fortunately, the waiting time is only a couple of weeks, and it's ideal for those who want to get this, who don't want to wait maybe 3 or 4 months to get the scan done. There's no fasting necessary. You drink about 500 mils, maybe in the hour or two before your scan, and the idea is just to hydrate you. You're allowed to empty your bladder, and so there's. But it's very important to remember that just because we're saying you don't have to do very much for the PET PSMA scan, it's different for other PET scans. So just because you've heard here that the PSMA scan, you can just show up, literally rock up and make sure you've drunk a bit of water. It's not the case with other PET scans. All right. This shows you how we're going to try to make a difference with the understanding of this technology. We've actually purposely designed this request form here in a manner that's going to help us collect data and to understand what we're doing. And you can see here we've got down where we will actually, we have to indicate why are we doing the PET scan, why the clinician is doing it. And we want to have some information about what the cancer was like at the time of diagnosis and what sort of treatment the patient has had in the past and what their very latest PSA is. And you can see that by pulling all that information together, we're going to learn a lot. Here at the Sydney Adventist Hospital, we actually are early adopters of the PET PSMA technology. And as such, we have a duty to collect the data and to share our experience and share our results. So one of the things we are very intent on doing is ultimately publishing our experience. So far, our experience here is well over 100 scans. So it's it's already building up to be a very reputable sort of experience. And I think that by the end of this year, in fact, when you think about it, over 100 scans, and we've only been going since towards the end of May. That's not bad going. And I think that the demand for this scan is only going to increase. All right, so on that note, there's only one last thing I would say about these scans, is that there is one disadvantage with this scan, and it's quite an expensive scan. And as you know, everything that's new that comes out that can be a benefit to men with prostate cancer initially goes for a period of time where it's not going to be covered by any Medicare rebates or by health funds. And so it's going to be one of these cases where we've got to hang in there, and ultimately I think this scan will be worthy of being covered. But it's impossible to say how long that will take. One way, another way of looking at this scan is that if we put... let's say if we do put funds aside for a rainy day, if it's been recommended that you have this scan, then it's probably a rainy day scan. On that note, I'll be happy to take any questions. Happy to take questions relevant to this presentation or anything to do with prostate cancer.
Thanks, Henry. It's been a very good talk. Just on the use of the scan, if one is on hormone therapy, how long do you need to be off hormone therapy to get good readings out of the scan?
That's at the moment we're just using a bit of judgment, trying to work out how to best do that. My personal belief is that we should wait until the testosterone at least recovers, and then. That would probably mark a reasonable line in the sand to see what happens. But at the moment, look, it's such a new scan. There are so many questions as to when is the right time to do a scan, and how to best utilize it to its full benefit. I think we'll understand that answer. That we'll have, may well have an answer to that question in a year or two, but at the moment it's very new.
So does the hormone therapy actually change the sensitivity of the scan, or is it... what's the mechanism there?
I don't think there's any evidence that the hormone treatment in fact changes the sensitivity of the scan. I think what it does is that it, I guess the risk you run when you do it whilst, let's say if you've got a man who's had non-metastatic prostate cancer and because of the very high grade disease was placed on hormone treatment. Now this scan's arrived on the scene, they think, oh, well, what if we could have a look for metastatic lesions with this scan? Well, the problem with, say, doing it whilst on the hormone treatment, the hormone treatment has shrunk all the metastatic deposits, and they may be too small to be seen on the scan. So that's a rationale but for stopping it, because you know, it sounds like sacrilege, what, you're going to let the cancer grow a bit, but the idea is you want to be able to see where it is, and that's the, you know, that's what you need to do. You've got to stop the hormone treatment sufficient for a sufficient amount of time so you can find what you're looking for.
Thanks.
I suspect in those cases you may actually, if you pull out this scan too soon, then you've just got to hang in there, repeat it again a little later on.
Yep.
A great question.
Thank you. Henry, what sort of dosage of radiation do you get from this scan compared to, say, MRI or CAT scans?
My understanding is that the dosage is very similar to a standard CT scan. So the idea of having something radioactive injected into your body sounds like, oh boy, this is, you know, it sounds quite uncomfortable, that the idea of it. But but you also remember that it actually dissipates very quickly. So therefore, if you come in to have this scan, when you go home, by dinner time, if you go and play with the grandkids or whatever, you're not likely to irradiate the kids. Because remember, it's got a very short half-life. And so imagine if you just go for at least three half-life cycles, how there's, you know, there really is very, very little radiation. And from the very beginning, there wasn't much radiation to begin with. These so-called gamma cameras are extraordinarily sensitive.
No, thank you. And just so we can plan for that rainy day one day, how much do we need to put aside?
At the moment, the scans in the public hospital systems, and there's two public hospitals offering it, I think they're around about $600 there. But they're also heavily subsidised. Now, it's not taking into account the real cost, the true cost. The public hospitals don't always factor in the true costs associated with running the service. And so therefore, when you do work, calculate the real cost, and it's almost just breaking even, it's around about $1,165 is the cost of a scan. But the main reason why you would pay the extra is because you're going to get the scan done a lot quicker. And I think that for this type of scan, when you think about it, you're getting the scan because you need to get something done. Yeah, one other thing about the cost is that obviously as technology improves and the numbers of men getting the scans increase, then efficiency, you know, come in and the price will come down. We've seen MRI come down in price. I remember when MRI of the prostate first came out, the going rate was around about, just over $1,000 per scan. It's now sort of settled down and come down to around about I think it's about $600, $650 for an MRI scan, and the price has been pretty much the same over the last two or three years now since the big initial drop. So I would foresee that PET scans will come down in price over time.
Henry, thanks to your good offices and this hospital, I've already had this procedure. What I'm wondering about, is there a limit as to how many you could have, should your condition warrant it?
I don't think there's any real limit. No more so than the number of CT scans that you could have. So as I said before, the radiation dose you get is really is not much different from a CT scan.
Henry. Is it the case that the scan is not sufficiently sensitive to pick up PSA readings below 0.2?
It's unlikely if a scan is going to pick up, or any scan is going to pick up disease when the PSA is that low.
Right.
You'll always get the odd case where it will.
Yeah.
But let's say, you know, we don't have good data, but let's say it was only 5%, so therefore you'd have 95% of men getting the scan prematurely, you could say, if the PSA was rising.
Yeah. So if you're down around the 0.02,
well, let's say that the main group we're talking about are those men who have undergone surgery in the past,
yeah,
and the PSA is starting to increase. And what we're balancing is that we don't want to get the scans so soon that the patient sort of, throw money into a PET PSMA scan that's shown nothing.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you don't want to leave it too late, because once the PSA gets over, say, 0.5, then you start the chances of having a successful outcome from the radiation, you lose a little bit off the success rate. It doesn't mean you can't, but certainly by the time you get to 1 nanogram per mil, then your success rate from post-prostatectomy radiation really starts to taper off. So ideally, you'd like to get the radiation done before it gets to 0.5, between 0.5 to 1 by that stage. So I think that we're going to find ourselves settling in somewhere between 0.2 and 0.5 as being the time to get the PSMA in that in that context.
Right, thank you.
The actual scan, that's from head to toe?
Yep, it's a total body scan.
Yep.
Indeed. Whereas mostly when you get a CAT scan, it's usually just of the abdomen, and you're hoping that you might pick up a lymph node. But really, you know, it's a very outdated scan. It, in fact, the number of times, the CAT scan is only going to really show something that's pretty big.
Yes, Henry, thanks very much. Thanks to your good efforts, I'm in good shape at the moment. I really appreciate it. Now, I'm just wondering, I have regular PSAs, and 5 years ago I had a brachytherapy, and 5 years ago I had the brachytherapy, and then the last couple of years, then it was sort of below 0.03, which don't read below that, and then it sort of was, you know, like that, and then about a year or two ago it went to 0.05, and then last time now it shows less than 0.01, but it's got a different entry. Instead of having PSA next to it, it's got PSA and brackets ARCH, and I can't for the life of me work out what that ARCH means. Is it a different way of measuring or what?
Just a different laboratory kit. They changed the kit.
Oh, I see. But yeah. But I mean, of course, that's going to next to zero. I mean, that's next to nothing. So I think
that's a spectacular outcome following brachytherapy, to have a PSA as low as almost undetectable.
Yeah.
Absolutely spectacular.
And I think it's 5 or 6 years now. It's 6 years.
Fantastic. Brilliant.
Yeah, thank you very much. Many thanks to you.
Oh, thank you. Great to hear that. It really is.
Henry, if you've had surgery, then you've followed up with radiation. If your PSA starts to rise, is drugs the only option then? You can't have radiation again, can you?
Not to the same spot. However, if the PET PSMA scan found a spot that was in a different area, then you can still have stereotactic radiation to that. So sometimes it can get very tight where you've had radiation to one area and as well as another area, and there's a lymph node in between those two areas, it creates some hard work for the radiation oncologist, and they have to really plan it carefully. But sometimes they can get through those very tight corners. To have a recurrence in the same area where you've had surgery and radiation treatment is extremely uncommon, because by the time you've had surgery, both surgery and radiation to one particular area, you've literally napalmed that area, and it's like almost nothing's going to survive.
My bowel knew that. That's quite fine.
Yeah.
Henry, with the tomotherapy machine that's now in the SCAN, is that more accurate than the old conventional?
Yeah, I would probably have to ask Richard Foster or Amy Tay to talk to that. What I understand of it is that it is able to provide a much more accurate aiming the beam.
Well, Henry, is this technology going to change the standard of care? Because it seems to me that the government works on a basis of step therapy, where you've got to basically fail one level before you go to the next level. And what I'm sort of gathering is that some of the diagnostic tools that are available may well be suggesting that a better medical process might be using a more, toxic treatment for a very specific situation, rather than sort of going through that sort of step functions. Would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, you're absolutely, it's a good comment you make there. The advent of this type of technology is really, it's forcing us to change the way we think. It's already forced us to have a re-look at treating those with the very aggressive cancer that we never thought about, and actually treating metastases. But we also need to have a very serious think about introducing systemic treatments in combination with the curative treatments with curative intent. For example, the study I would love to see introduced at some stage is where, after surgery, that we also give the patients chemotherapy, but not the hormone treatment.
Yep.
I'd love to see that.
Yep. It seems to me that there's some gap between what the medicos want to do and what the government wants to do.
Correct. Well, at the moment, it's going to be very hard, because it's an incredibly exciting time to be in prostate cancer right now. Maybe not so much if you... Well, even for those who have got the disease, it's because of the fact that so much progress has occurred in just recent years. And you see how full the drug cabinet is compared to a few years ago. It's amazing all these new agents that are available that you'd never dreamed would be available now. And before it was just, imagine that, before it was just you had various forms of hormone treatment was all we had for quite a long time, and a chemotherapy that didn't work. And then once Taxotere arrived, it was only a very modest improvement in survival, but the reason why everybody was so happy was because we'd never come across anything that actually made a difference before, and that provided the very first building block for improvement. It's something to build upon.
Just one other thing. In today's paper, or in the last couple of days, the government sort of seems to be moving on reducing funding for PSA tests and also bone mineral density tests. People down there with small brains, or what's the problem?
Look, at the end of the day, look, you look cynically at it, a lot of it's, to me, it seems the primary objective is to find a way to reduce cost. And what I fear with the way this is going to be done in a lot of areas, not just in procedures and tests which are relevant to prostate cancer, is that in quite a number of instances, it will be a case of the baby being thrown out with the bathwater.
Yeah, because at the advanced end, you certainly need those sort of tests more frequently than the other end, where routine scanning. That's it. Thank you.
I have another one which I've been wondering. Lymph nodes, when they're taken, does the body regenerate lymph nodes, or they're gone forever? So where do you get your sampling from after that?
Well, what actually happens is that there's a huge abundance of lymph glands in the pelvis, and we have our, preferred lymph nodes that we take out routinely. Now, there's been some changes in our whole approach to lymph node dissection. We had what we call a standard template, which is what we did for many years. And then for a period probably lasting about a year, or some people are still doing it, we switched over to what we call extended pelvic lymph node dissection, where we just went for broke, and we just, in terms of removing as much as you could. And so therefore you had really extensive lymph node dissections, which meant you're taking out a lot of tissue, but at the same time you're increasing that material risk of complications like lymphedema in particular. And so that's why some people have been very uncomfortable, because quite a number of men have actually experienced lymphedema as a consequence of that. But again, that was pretty much a blunderbuss approach where you just try to take everything out in hope that you pick up a positive lymph node. But with these scans now being, you know, in a position to help point us in the right direction, I think that's making people less enthusiastic about the aggressive approach. The other thing I don't like about the aggressive approach with surgery is that, let's just say, there is a lymph, because you don't take out every, it's impossible to take out every single lymph node, it really is. But let's say there was a sneaky little lymph node which was just sort of around the corner from where you removed the main group of lymph nodes, and that was positive and you wanted to give that radiation. If you've done a really extensive lymph node dissection and then you give radiation, then that person is going to be very likely to get scarring of the lymph channels, the remaining lymph channels, and could end up with a very big swollen leg. You know how women get a big swollen arm sometimes after a mastectomy, after lymph node dissection in the armpit? The lymphedema in the leg, I think, is far more debilitating than lymphedema in the arm. Oh. Not taking anything away from women who've suffered from lymphedema, but with the arm, it's relatively easy to put the arm up. The leg is, you know, it's always, most of the time, it's down there because you're walking on it. It's quite a debilitating problem.
Henry, here I am.
Oh, there you are.
The lymph nodes. Are you doing that in a robotic procedure?
Yes, it definitely. Oh. Yeah. I've got to say that with the robot, I actually think it's my personal experience anyway, I've actually found that it's actually easier to do a lymph node dissection using the robot than it is to do it with open surgery. Mm. Technically, I found it easier.
Thank you.
Is that because of the greater magnification that you're able to employ?
No, I don't think it's due to that. I think it's because the way we've got the patient tilted down and all the bowel just falls out the way. Because when you've got somebody, when you're operating in an open, the patient's lying flat.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes some people would tilt the head down a little bit, but not in the exaggerated manner in which we do with robotic surgery.
Which way are they tilted?
Head down.
Head down.
Oh my goodness, I wouldn't like that.
What about the blood rushing to the head?
Well, they finally get some blood to the head.
Henry, can I just ask you, these days it's fairly routine to have heart, lung transplants, kidney transplants, liver and so on. Why can't you have a prostate gland transplant?
Oh boy. I guess that a lot of it's got to do with the fact that the prostate has a very complex blood supply. It's not just like you've got one main feeding vessel. Like with a kidney, there's one feeding artery and there's one draining vein. You know, so that makes a kidney transplant actually technically fairly, by today's standards, a very easy operation. But and even with liver transplants, there are still, you've got a major artery that goes in, you've got a major vein that comes out, and you've got the major biliary duct that comes out, and you've just got to attach the three of them. It sounds easier than I'm making out. But with the prostate, we don't have one big sort of vessel that goes into it. And there's multiple vessels, and therein lies a problem. And these vessels are also quite small. So you've got lots and lots of them, which may be, say, 2 millimetres, 3 millimetres in diameter. And if you had to sew each one of those together to find the matching, that's the other thing, is that there may be a mismatch in the vessels, because the vascular anatomy can vary so much from man to man. Mm. But I'm not sure that you feel.
So it's never been tried?
No, it's never been tried, but wouldn't it be a great shame you get the transplanted prostate in and then you get this condition called BPH and it blocks your waterworks and you can't pee. So you inherit the, you know, the previous owner's, you know, waterworks problems.
What about, that brings me a thought, what about stem cells?
Look, I haven't, you know, there's been a lot of talk about stem cells for, you know, probably a good 10 years at least, and it's probably been one of the great disappointments to this point in time. And so none of the, I guess, the I guess, what we thought were positive, you know, vibes have actually come to fruition as you know, meaningful therapies for treating prostate cancer. It's a bit of a shame.
Yeah.
But look, there may well be people who are still working on various leads, but to this point in time, I think it has been quite a disappointment. But fortunately, it's been made up for by a lot of the new therapeutic agents that have been developed.
Thank you, Henry. Is there one last question?
Yes, Henry, going back to that scenario just that I described, is it not usual or unusual for, you know, let's say after 3-4 years for it to go up a little bit to 0.05 and then now to zero? Isn't that trend set up more or less when it starts going in the wrong direction, which is up? And supplementary to that is that, as you know, I'm a great believer in supplementation, and selenium kills cancer cells in rats at least. And so I take a lot of selenium, and do you think that might have something to do with it?
Probably not. The thing about radiation treatment, its effect on the prostate, is that it, as you know, radiation attacks cells that divide more rapidly than normal cells, and that's where, because prostate cancer cells do actually divide more rapidly than normal prostate cells, they're the ones which have the greatest harm is to those cells. Some benign cells still survive the radiation. That is, non-cancerous cells will survive the radiation, and they're capable of producing small amounts of PSA, which can sort of fluctuate, because radiation can cause an inflammatory process within the gland. And because of the fact that PSAs can fluctuate after radiation, that's why the definition for PSA biochemical failure after radiation is set as being the PSA nadir plus 2.4, just a plus 2. So therefore you can get these fluctuations. Now the very low level fluctuations, which is like what you're getting at the moment, I can reassure you is nothing unusual. In fact, it's very common to see that.
Well, Henry, on behalf of our group, I would like to thank you very much for a most informative session presentation to us. I'm sure we've learned a lot of what's happening, and it amazes me how people come up with all these new avenues, or it's just continuing happening from time to time. Thank Henry in our usual form, please.